Okay, so let's go where we are, where we stopped this morning. We stopped with the seven responses, the seven, as we call them, the biological responses. This is where we stopped, okay? The seventh level of biological response. As I said, at some point before the end, today is Wednesday, but by Friday evening, I will cover everything else that was the intention, that we had the intention to cover. So now we'll explore. Deeper questions based on what we explored this morning. This is a phrase from the Bhagavad Gita, one of the Upanishads. I am the field, I am the knower of the field. So the field, the Sanskrit word for that is kshetra, and the knower of the field is kshetragya in Sanskrit. What is the field? The field is consciousness. So I am the field of consciousness, but I'm also the knower of the field of consciousness. So consciousness knows itself as experience. I'm sticking with that word because it's easy, okay? Everybody knows all the time that they're having an experience. So I'm the field, and I'm the knower of the field, the knower of all experience, which is also in consciousness. Okay. We're skipping this for now, okay? This is a very interesting course that I do at business school, but now we're interested in God, not business. So, how do we know God? First of all, how do we define God? You know, and we should start by saying that to define God is to limit God. If God is infinite, then God is not subject to definition. Every definition of God is a limitation to the understanding of God. And yet we need maps, so here we go. God is our highest instinct to know ourselves. As humans, we aspire to know ourselves. And so the mystery that we call God, the mystery that we call existence, the mystery that we call ourself, mere mystery, is our highest instinct as humans. And the experience of God depends on our state of awareness. We already said that this morning. God is as we know. So here is how humans have thought about God through the ages. Remember that all religious literature, of course, came through human beings. It wasn't that God suddenly descended to write the Bible or any other text. Religion is frequently referred to by the founders of religion as revealed truth, revelation. So, of course, whoever wrote about God in the great religious texts was a human being, or many human beings, and they were in a particular state of consciousness when they wrote what they wrote. So if they were in the fight or flight response, then they thought of God. When you're scared, you need somebody to protect you. So the way they conceived of God was their protector. But like a parent who is not obeyed, God was also sometimes mean-spirited, vengeful, capricious, could get angry easily, was jealous, was unfathomable, was judgmental. And the world that God created was a world where we had to survive. And we had to make sure that we could continue to live. So very basic kind of understanding of God from a person or people who are in fact living in those conditions, which by the way have been the dominant conditions of humanity even now. If you look everywhere in the world, you know, more than 60% of the world is in, or more than that, is in the mode of survival. And so this myth, if I may say, by myth I don't mean to denigrate it, but this story, this interpretation, this idea of God is still there. You read the Bible, this is the first God that appears. Okay, read any other religious text, you'll find this version of God as well. Eastern, Western, wherever you go. But then some people went a little bit beyond that. They were in the reactive response. And remember, the reactive response is about control, right? Control drama, being nice, being nasty, being stubborn, being manipulative in a sense, being sometimes playing the victim. This people who were in this response, they conceived of God, which means they put a limitation on God. Okay, conceived means defining God in some way or another. They defined God as the ultimate control freak. Okay, because we project reality as we are. Right? So God is sovereign, almighty, complete controller of the world, omnipotent, but also just, also listening to our prayers, rational, impartial, organized into rules. And, you know, the person who obeys God the best, follows, let's say, the Ten Commandments, gets the prize. So the world that God created is the world of competition and ambition. Again, you'll find this God everywhere, in all the religions of the world that were again conceived, written down, put into writing by human beings in a particular state of consciousness. God is as we are. The world is as we are. The world and God and we go together. Because the world that we find ourselves in is the world or people that we find ourselves in are people who are in more or less the same stage of evolution as we are. Like you are hanging out with people who are similar to you here. While we are here doing this, the people in Las Vegas doing something else. Okay? And they're hanging out and they're creating their own world, right? And for them, that's the world. Like this is the world for us right now. So this is the world we create, both personally, because we find ourselves with people in the same domain of consciousness as us. And if you find ourselves with people who are in the same domain of consciousness as us, then we project that, we create that reality. We create that construct, our collective construct. As we go into the restful awareness response, as we start to get centered, then that's what we project on the mystery that we call God. We are peaceful, so God is the peace that passes understanding. God is detached and calm. This God shows up in the West, in the New Testament, as Jesus. And of course, also in many Eastern traditions, Buddha, etc. So now, although Buddha didn't use the word God, we experience God as one who offers consolation, one who's silent, approached through meditation and deep understanding. And we also find ourselves in an environment that has solitude and self-sufficiency. So we are kind of beginning to be in that environment here right now. Third response. In the intuitive response, the God that we collectively project. By the way, whatever we project, we also experience. It's not only that we conceive and construct, we become that experience. Consciousness conceives, constructs, governs, and becomes the experience. So, as we are in the intuitive response, God is the Redeemer. Why? Because God now knows the answers. Because we know the answers. We are tapping into the answers. So we extend that, we project that to that which is above us, our Creator is our Redeemer. God understands, and therefore, because God understands, God is tolerant and forgiving and non-judgmental and inclusive and accepting. New Testament is also an elaboration of this intuitive response. The Sermon on the Mount. What kind of world did God create? Which is another world, way of saying what kind of world we create is the world of insight and personal growth. Again, we are experiencing that here, I hope. As we go into the creative response, now we see, you know, we are expressing our creativity, so we amplify our experience of creativity and project that to God as the Creator. Unlimited creative potential, abundance, control over space and time, open, willing to be known, inspired, generous. The book of Genesis expresses this God. Again, whatever I say, it's found in all the religions. What kind of God did world did God create? The world of art, invention, discovery, creativity. As we move into the higher guidance, visionary response, God is one who gives us miracles. So let's look at that whole thing about miracles, because every religion has miracles. Every religion. There's report of miracles. Right? So, why is that so? Why does every religion describe miracles? I think miracle is a word we use in the absence of understanding what happened. If you can explain a phenomenon, then you no longer call it a miracle. Okay. Why did that drop to the ground? Oh, gravity. Well, what's gravity? It's when there's an object and there's another object, they attract each other. Why? It's the curvature of space-time. What's the curvature of space-time? It's a mathematical construct. Shut up and calculate. That's a miracle. This is a miracle. Just because you have an explanation doesn't mean anything. Because the explanation is a human construct to explain a mode of knowing or experience. I'll repeat that. The explanation is a human construct, means a human conception to explain a mode of knowing or experience. What is the mode of knowing? If I let this go, it drops. Now I have to explain it. And once I explain it, through whatever explanation I come from, for the moment, It's not a miracle anymore. If I raise my hand, how does that thought become this energy information? Actually, that's a real miracle because we don't know so far. Okay, we don't know so far. How am I pulling out words from my vocabulary right now in a certain sequential order so that I can speak a sentence with syntax and grammar and hopefully it makes sense to you? Nobody knows. I mean, I have so many words in my vocabulary. Why this particular sequence and how am I pulling them out? Just by thinking or by intending. So once again, what we refer to as a miracle is a human construct, a human conception of a mode of knowing and experience that we cannot explain. Once we explain it to our satisfaction, then we no longer call it a miracle. That's why Einstein did say something very sensible. He said, either everything is a miracle or nothing is a miracle. Does the explanation we have actually explain anything? If you say the gravity, curvature of space-time, mathematical formulation, does it really explain anything? So the deeper reality, if you really ask honest scientists, is there an explanation for any phenomenon? The answer is no. In fact, I met a great mathematician recently from Columbia University who's been at, he's actually Russian, he lives part-time in Europe. I won't name him right now, but he's a revered figure in mathematics. He said explanation is a silly word, we shouldn't use it. Just dismissed it. We shouldn't use. There's no explanation for anything. But, you know, as human beings, we like to divide things, make maps. So, what is a miracle? It's something that we cannot explain. And then we come up with an explanation, and then we say, now it's not a miracle anymore. So, just as an aside, I recently was invited to join one of the boards at the Vatican by His Holiness Pope Francis. And so I paid a visit to the Vatican. And one of the things that's very impressive over there is that if you go to the vaults and all the records of the Vatican, they have hundreds of miracles. In fact, that's their criteria for coming up with who's going to be a saint. You know, the saint must have performed, I think, 3 miracles in their life in order to qualify, and then they get their degree. Okay? You're now a saint. So, and these are documented miracles. And mostly, by the way, they're healings. So somebody had an illness like cancer or some other severe illness, and then they had a holy experience, and now they don't have it. What in science sometimes we refer to as spontaneous remissions. Science documents these, but we don't call them miracles because, you know, those are words for the Pope and other people. We are scientists, so we'll call them spontaneous remissions, which is another word for we don't know what happened. Okay? So now because I work with Rudy and other geneticists, it occurred to me, and I'm not the only one, that when people heal, what has happened is that there is a change in their gene expression. And that gene expression, not the genes don't change, but the expression of the genes change, that experience is a result of epigenetic mechanisms. I can talk about that later, maybe even show you some of the research we've done at the Chopra Foundation on that. But suddenly now we have an explanation that, you know, the genes that are involved in self-regulation or homeostasis, they get upregulated, the genes that cause too much inflammation, they get downregulated, and in some people, that's enough to get rid of the disease, spontaneous remission. A lot of these people have fervent belief and faith in that particular modality of experience. So maybe going to the Vatican and listening to Pope Francis give a sermon, Mass on Christmas Eve could be an amazing experience. Or going to Guadalupe, the Virgin Mary could be an amazing experience. Not necessarily for somebody who belongs to ISIS, but definitely to a devout Catholic. And that then, that's a mechanism that triggers at a deep level an intention that orchestrates an epigenetic phenomenon that results in complete self-regulation or healing. So actually, Rudy and I are doing a book on that right now. It's called The Healing Self. It'll be out next year. So actually, I suggested to some of the people at the Vatican, I said, you know, we can do a study. You know, people come here, devout Catholics come here, and, you know, it's a mystery why I'm part of your board, but there must be a reason. It's the board for science and technology and art, just so you know. And so I said, maybe we can do a study. You know, some people do this, and other people go to Costco, and then we'll see the difference in their genes. And they like the idea, so we are pursuing it. Okay. So, in a way, we can say nothing has an explanation, or we can create human constructs where everything has an explanation. But as long as we are confused, then it's something extraordinary, when in fact our existence is extraordinary. That's the biggest miracle. But in this visionary response, when we are tapping into archetypal symbolic representations of higher consciousness, then we experience God as transformative, mystical, enlightened, beyond all causes, healing, magical, the cosmic alchemist, if you want to say. And then we find ourselves hanging out with people who live in this world, mythical world of prophets and seers and people who are constantly engaged in this kind of, or even to the point of being obsessed with mystical powers, alchemy, etc., etc. In the sacred response, God is pure being. I am that I am. So it's part of our meditation, isn't it? I am Deepak Chopra, I am Deepak, I am, and on till even I am disappears. Okay, which is the ground of being. This is part of our daily practice now. Okay, at this level, God is timeless, unborn, infinite, undying, intangible, unchanging, invisible. This is the only stage where we can say God is not a projection. Every other stage, God is a projection. This stage, God is reality. God is the source of all existence. And then in this stage, we find ourselves, if we hang out with the right people, we find ourselves in the transcendent. Transcendent means beyond space-time and causality, in the transcendent world of all possibilities, infinite possibilities, eternal, timeless being. Okay, now let's keep going on the same direction. Now we've created the map, so once we have a map, we can see where everything fits, like a big jigsaw puzzle. So now we want to answer these different questions. Who am I? How do I fit in? How do I find God? What is the nature of good and evil? People struggle with all these questions from their particular state of awareness. So in the fight-flight response, who am I means, what do I identify myself with? Okay? So in the fight-flight response, I'm a survivor. How do I fit in? I cope. That's the best I can do. I'm struggling. How do I find God? Through fear and loving devotion. What is the nature of good and evil? Good is physical safety, comfort, food, shelter, and family. Evil is a threat to that. See, everything, all of reality is how I am, where I am in my stage of development or my stage of evolution. In the reactive response, I am my ego personality. Who are you? I'm a billionaire. My bank account shows so much money. I'm the president of this organization. I am the chairman of the board of such and such. Everything that goes into inflating your ego as your bio. That's who you are. How do I fit in? I win. Have you heard this word recently a lot? All that matters is I win. How do I find God? Through awe and obedience, but that's how you find me too. What is the nature of good and evil? Good is getting what you want, fulfilling all your ego desires mainly. You know, evil is a threatening to getting what you want, to your ego values and your needs. That's how you interpret good and evil. The stock market falls, that's evil. In a sense, that's how the world is seen. In the restful awareness, centered awareness response, now I'm getting there slowly, I'm getting there. I like to say this is the beginning of the 1% phenomenon. 99% of the world is stuck in the first two levels. We're not saying this condescendingly, just realistically speaking, looking at what's happening in the world, we can easily say that 99 and more percentage of the world is in the first two levels. Okay, but now, because I'm beginning to understand reality, I'm the silent witness. How do I fit in? I remain myself. I don't let the seer be overshadowed by the scenery. How do I find God? Through contemplative self-inquiry, which is what we do with our practice, right? Who am I? What do I want? What's my purpose? Those are the big questions. What am I grateful for? So we're beginning to engage in contemplative self-inquiry, and with meditation we are also beginning to transcend. And here, what is good and evil? Good is clarity. It's being restful, alert, a sense of orderliness, peace of mind. Evil is turmoil and inner chaos. In the intuitive response, so go back. In the intuitive response, I'm not only the silent witness, I am the knower within the silent witness. I know what's going on. See, this is very important for us to understand. When we define consciousness or awareness, awareness is the knowing element in every experience. I'll repeat that. Awareness is the knowing element in every experience. And how does awareness know? By feeling, by thinking, by perceiving, by sensing. That knowing element is in every biological organism. If I take a paramecium, an amoeba, it has a knowing element. It'll move in the direction of food and it will avoid toxins. There's a knowing element in every bit of awareness in every biological organism. But that knowing element expands in us as intuition and creativity and knowing at a deeper level the context of everything. So who am I? I'm the knower within. How do I fit in? I understand. What do I understand, by the way? I understand that everyone in the world is doing what they are capable of from the state of consciousness they're in. I understand that everyone in the world is doing what they're capable of from the state of consciousness they're in. That's why you can't tell anyone what to do. You can't convince them through rational thought. Don't even try. So how do I go? How do I find God now? Through self-acceptance. Because when I look inside myself, I realize I have those tendencies too. I have my own shadows. I have my own conflicts. I have my own struggles. When I forgive myself, I forgive the other. You don't forgive the other because you think they deserve forgiveness. Nobody ever thinks anybody else deserves forgiveness. You forgive the other because you deserve peace. And you deserve to find self-acceptance. What is the nature of good and evil? Well, good is receiving answers to your questions. That's where we're cultivating this habit of asking questions. Who am I? With every meditation, what do I want? What's my purpose? Because if you live those questions, as we evolve, the answers also evolve. And not only the answers evolve, our life moves in the direction of the answers. Live the questions and let the answers come spontaneously, either as insight, intuition, relationships, situations, circumstances, events. So good is knowingness. Evil is not trusting yourself, threat to your own intuition. Why? Because once in a while, ego, which is full of doubt, starts to creep in. One thing to ask yourself when you're in doubt, who is in doubt? Who or what is having this doubt? Because your awareness is never in doubt. It's your ego that's in doubt. So you can tell your ego, I doubt you. Doubt the doubt. In the creative response, who I become is a co-creator with the infinite mind, with the infinite being, which is the ground of the universe. How do I fit in? I learn to become a creator in every aspect of my life. In the creation of my relationships, in the creation of my circumstances, in the creation of my circumstances, which means I assume that the circumstances I'm in right this moment is my creation. In the beginning, by the way, if you doubt that, just assume that it's true. Every situation is your creation. You say, what about, you know, I went by the building and, you know, a rock fell out of the building and it hit my head. And I had a concussion, went to the hospital. How did I do that? And the answer is, you walked by the building. Right? And you chose that, either consciously or unconsciously, but you chose that. If you're really in the intuitive response, maybe you wouldn't be walking by that building. Okay? So again, even though it seems kind of unfair, you can assume that it's true for the beginning, for now. So what is the nature of good and evil? Good is inspiration, evil is lower consciousness, threat to creativity. Higher guidance, who am I? Enlightened awareness, I realize that's a word that may or may not mean anything, but enlightened awareness means just that the awareness is more than personal. It's tapping into the archetypal, collective Why not? Let's use the word collective unconscious or collective consciousness. How do I fit in at this time? I find myself that love is the best way to fit in any situation. Any situation. How do I find God? Through what spiritual traditions call grace. But we can use other words, spontaneous fulfillment of desire, meaningful coincidences, synchronicity, unusual happenings that all have to do with intention and fulfillment of intention. So, you know, depending on your orientation, you might say God is on my side, which is another way of saying everything happens in a way that, you know, fulfills my intentions. I'm lucky. You can say I'm lucky if you don't believe in God. Or you can say there are lots of meaningful coincidences happening in my life, a lot of synchronicities. You can say it's a state of grace. You can say I'm in the right place. I find myself in the right place at the right time. These are words to mean that there's no struggle in your life. Intentions are organizing their own fulfillment. So, what we call this in our, now that the meditation has been complete, right? Meditation is complete. Four intentions at the end. So, lightness of being. Right? Everything before that is also happening. Joyful, energetic body, loving, compassionate heart, reflective, alert mind, lightness of being. What is the nature of good and evil? Good is the cosmic force of evolution, truth, beauty, harmony. In Sanskrit, the word for that is sattva. Here is one way to think about it. When you find being in an object, when you find your being connected to an object, that experience is beauty. When you find your being connected to another being, although this is also a being, but let's say to another human being or an animal, that experience is called love. So love and beauty are the same thing. Okay. We say beauty when we refer to objects, art, nature. We say love when we refer to other beings. But they're the same thing. In fact, in Sanskrit, Satyam Shivam Sundaram. Satyam means truth. Shivam means love, and Sundaram means beauty. Shivam means love in its essence. Not just as an emotion, but the ultimate truth. Okay, so truth, love, beauty are the same thing. Tagore used to say, when I feel beauty, I know it is truth and it is love. So at this point, what is good? It's the force of evolution that expresses itself as truth, beauty, harmony. What is evil? It's another force. It's not seen as a personal threat. It's just tamas, inertia. So the forces are evolution on one side, inertia on the other side, and then the play of creation, that is the tension between both. What's the most inertial thing we can think of? Matter. We think of matter associated with heaviness. The bigger the mass, the more the matter, the more inertia. And what's the extreme opposite of that? Pure creativity or awareness. And you need both in order to have experience. Remember, the on-off, you need both. So now you don't see evil in the world. You only see as a force of inertia. Well, then a lot of people then say that we tolerate evil. You know, how about the Holocaust? How about, you know, Syria, what's happening? And the answer is no, because as you're evolving, you are evolving in the favor of truth, goodness, beauty, harmony. So you, in a way, you put your allegiance in that stream of evolution. How do you put your allegiance in that? You do everything to minimize in your own life the forces, the shadows that we all have. You do everything in your own life to favor truth, goodness, beauty, harmony, love, compassion, joy, equanimity, all the things we've been talking about. And then you hopefully hang out with other people who are doing the same. And then you create, ultimately, you hope to create a critical mass where what we call evolution overshadows inertia or entropy. But you don't become an angry peace activist. Because then you're a contradiction right there, right? Angry peace activist. You can only create peace if you're peaceful. Okay, you can only create love if you have experienced love and you are the giver and recipient of love. So it all has to do with critical mass of consciousness. Now in the Vedanta, they go into details, you know, like there are yugas or eons of time where good prevails, and then there are times where good does not prevail as much, but it overshadows what they call evil. Then there are times when they are playing together in balance, good and evil are the same proportion. And then there are eons of time when there is only darkness and struggle and war and pestilence and terrorism and everything that is inertia, which, by the way, is called Kali Yuga, the worst kind of part of the cycle, and we are supposed to be in it, which is good news because we can only go up. Okay. In the sacred response, who am I? I am the source. How do I fit in? I am. Even beyond I am is a word. How do I find God? Transcendence. I've gone beyond the play of all opposites. I like to say, I've picked up my badge in the insane asylum. This is the visitor's badge. We're in it, but now we have our badge. So at this point, evil doesn't exist. There's an understanding that Maya means the projection, the illusion. She's the goddess, the veil that she puts on to cover up the real reality, that Maya is needed to keep the relative world going. So what is the relative world? The relative world is the world of experience. The absolute world is the world of spirit. Okay, so we need Maya in order to see the play of cosmic consciousness. This is a virtual reality playground in cosmic consciousness, what we are in right now. And it's the projection. Okay. What is my life challenge? Which is, what do I want to do right now in order to get to the next stage? What is my greatest strength? What is my biggest hurdle? What is my greatest temptation? We're trying to kind of fit all the pieces together. So in the fight-flight response, what I need to do right now is to survive, to protect, to maintain. Survive. But having done that at the next stage, my greatest challenge, okay, no, we haven't come to that. What's my greatest strength in the fight-flight response? It's courage. What's my biggest hurdle? The opposite, fear. What's my greatest temptation? Tyranny. Because if I become a mind-body expert in the fight-flight response, I end up being Hitler or Saddam Hussein or anyone else you can think of who is a despot in the world. These people are fight flight experts. Their reptilian brain is totally developed, but nothing else is. In the reactive response, what my greatest challenge? Maximum achievement. You cannot achieve anything in your life in terms of fame, fortune, or how the world defines success unless you have some ego, right? And there's another way to achieve things as we move forward, but for practical purposes, money, success in the way the world defines it, fame and fortune, you need some element of ego. And so your greatest strength is you're able to accomplish. Your biggest hurdle is that when you're not able to accomplish, then you become a victim. Okay, it's somebody's fault. And your greatest temptation is addiction, an escape. In the restful awareness response, your challenge is to be engaged and detached at the same time. Which means the seer has to remain calm and engage in the scenery, which is usually chaotic. So that's your challenge. What's your greatest strength? Autonomy. You are going to not depend on anyone else to engage in the world. What's your biggest hurdle, if you take it literally, that it's all karma, that the biggest hurdle is, it's all karma, it's fatalism. And that is a misunderstanding of karma. Okay. Karma creates the situations of the present moment. After that, it's a choice. And the choice depends on how you react to the situation. Do you find it a challenge? Do you find it an opportunity? Do you find it a problem? So in other words, the hurdle is an opportunity if you are waking up to the power of your being or the power of presence. If you're not waking up to it, then it's fatalism. This is the big question that people ask philosophers for thousands of years. Do we have free will, or is everything determined? Or is everything already determined? After all, we said earlier, past, present, and future is all correlated, right? So here's the answer to that, is for most people, everything is determined. Why? Because they are caught in the prison of karma and they don't know it. For those of who are waking up to the presence of their being, there are degrees of freedom, depending on how awake you are, till ultimately there's ultimate total freedom. That stage of total freedom is also called enlightenment. Okay. So what's your biggest hurdle? Fatalism. And what's your greatest temptation? Well, if everything is already determined, then your temptation is apathy. You don't want to be engaged. You are so centered that you can't engage in the world. You might as well go live in a cave. It's a temptation for a lot of people who become monks, etc., go to monasteries and live in ashrams. Not saying this again in a way that it's condescending, but for them that's the escape route. Empathy to the world and what's happening around them. Intuitive response. Greatest challenge, to go beyond duality. Okay, remember, intuition is context related. Intuition comes from when I go beyond the idea of me and other. So my challenge is to go beyond this idea that me and other are actually separate. Me and other are woven into each other's existence. So I have to start thinking of that. Whoever I'm dealing with, that person and I, or whatever situation, we are woven together in this web that we call karma. And our challenge is to go beyond the idea that I am separate from everything else that's happening around me. What's the greatest strength? Insight. I have a deeper understanding. What's the biggest hurdle? Mood making. I pretend to be more intuitive than I am. It's a temptation. You know who has the biggest temptation? Psychics. Some of them are very good. But even the good ones, they will pretend to be better than they are. And so what's your greatest temptation? Deception. See, psychics have a window into non-locality. That's what they have a window to. How many people have once or sometime consulted or been in the presence of somebody called a psychic or who says they're psychic? So many of you. And so you'll say, you know, they're very good, but sometimes they miss. Right? And you only remember the things that they don't miss. So psychics have a window into if they're real psychics, they definitely have a window into non-locality. But who has a bigger window into non-locality? And this is my own bias, because I don't want to ever have a situation where somebody has a non-local insight or ability or a window and they're hit and miss. They're dead on. And the window here is autistic children, autistic savants. In fact, that's some of the research we are now taking as the Chopra Foundation, is we are identifying these children who are basically, word savant means genius or saint. So in some way, they have a mechanism where they're not so tuned into this world, but they're tuned into one aspect of a non-local world. And they won't try to deceive you. They're innocent kids who just happen to have that window. So actually, in 2 weeks from now, I'm going to New Jersey to see a kid who's only 10 years old in New Jersey, of Indian origin, but born here, who is one of those savants. You know, can look into the future, tell you about the past, etc. How long is that video that I asked you to dig out? Show the 6-minute version, because I have a 3-hour version. So let's see the 6-minute.
Neuroscientist Thorsten Fehr of Bremen University specializes in studying people with gargantuan powers of memory. Mathematics genius Rüdiger Gamm is his most spectacular case so far.
0,3 7 1 2 5 5 4 0 2 9 9 4 0 1 1 9 7 6 0 4 7 9 0 4 1 1 6 1 6 4 6 7 0 6 5 8 6 8 2 6 3 4 7 3 0 5 9 2 1 7 0 6 4.
The human brain is the most mysterious piece of matter on Earth. It was just as effective in the Middle Ages as it is on the internet. It's been used to invent symphonies and to devise violent crimes. Yet it's only now, in the 21st century, with high-tech computers, that scientists have begun to watch the brain while it's actually thinking. Their most important discovery is that it's almost a miracle that this peculiar thing in our heads works at all. But certain miracles are only noticeable when something goes wrong. as it has for a group of people of less than 100 in number worldwide who display astonishing, almost supernatural abilities. Despite their mental disabilities, they are capable of things for which science is only now beginning to find an answer. Scientists call these people savants, the knowing ones. And more than half of these mysterious people are autistic. Experts all over the world are now working on the question, is there a hidden genius within all of us?
When he was about 4 and a half, he had memorized the first 8 volumes of a set of encyclopedias, which happened to be the index volumes.
After just 1 helicopter flight, Stephen Wiltshire can draw the entire aerial perspective of cities. But he didn't speak his first words, pen and paper, until he was 5. As a child, Matt Savage couldn't stand bodily contact. Sounds drove him crazy. At 6, he learned to play the piano. Overnight. He's been composing jazz since he was 7.
He says to us that the music is already in him. He just understands these things that normally people have to learn. He reads it, he absorbs it, and it's his.
The human brain combines the appearance of a large walnut with the consistency of a soft-boiled egg. Yet nothing in the entire universe is as complicated as this slippery lump of more than 100,000 million neurons. The secret of thought has occupied human brains for centuries. In anatomy collections around the world, elite brains have been held in storage, in the hope of someday finding out exactly what it is that makes people geniuses.
We tend to think of ourselves as being born with a blank disc and a beautiful piece of machinery called the brain, and we become whatever we put on the blank disc. That is what we are. But in order to explain the prodigious savant, you have to answer the question, how can somebody know something that they've never learned?
January 1st, 1957.
Tuesday.
That's right. March 28th, 1957.
Thursday.
That's right. May 30th, 1957.
Thursday.
That's right. March 27th, 1958.
Thursday.
That's right. June 10th, 1954.
Thursday.
That's right. September 22nd, 1954.
Wednesday.
That's it. December 4th, 1954.
Sunday.
No, it was a Saturday. About June 1st,
Orlando Sorrell is a so-called acquired savant, the term for those who are not born savants, but who suddenly become one, through an accident, an epileptic fit, or a stroke. As a 10-year-old, Virginian Orlando Sorrell was a very ordinary boy. But on the 15th of January, 1979, he was hit on the head by a baseball, so hard he lost consciousness. Since then, Orlando knows the day of the week and the weather on every date after his accident, without thinking about it. Only now, at our test at the National Institute of Health in Washington, does it become clear that Orlando's knowledge of the dates before his accident is also improving, without any practice at all.
I don't really know of a savant who has done that before, has been able to report the events with the date in the same way. So that's, to me, what's most impressive. August 27th, 1988.
Saturday. Right. I was hanging out that night.
How about July 4th, 1989?
Tuesday. July 1st, Saturday, I was at a friend's house cooking. I had to cook barbecue chicken. They were part of chicken, the legs.
January 5th, 1986.
Sunday.
That's right.
January 3rd, Friday, I was at my cousin's house doing some recording on some cassette tapes.
February 7th, 1983.
Monday, February 11th, Friday, it rained that day, had pizza from Domino's, pepperoni sausage.
December 11th, 1991.
Wednesday, December 13th, Friday, I didn't go to work that day.
Okay.
What is it about Orlando's brain that allows him to retain the things that most of us would discard through even the moments of the day? And so I think it's very striking to understand the capacity of the brain. If he can remember all of these details, then can all of us remember, you know, much more than we are on a day-to-day basis?
Can just one knock on the head make our memory infinite? Orlando, a janitor at Walmart, shows the researchers where the ball hit him. Scientists have tested him often, and it's been proven that on all the weather data after 1979, Orlando has never made a mistake.
October 13th, Saturday, it was cloudy. It had one of those pullover hoods. This part right here was black, and it was cloudy. And this girl that I know went across the street to the convenience store. She had on white tennis shoes, white socks, blue jeans, and a yellow one on pullover top. And that was October 13th, Saturday, 84, Run DMC, Curtis Blow, and the Fat Boys at the Hampton Coliseum when the people got mugged in the parking lot. Now, that's too much stuff to hold it into one brain. We're talking about 20 years ago.
So what's the what we call the normal human brain? It is the product of the conditioned mind. Okay, it's the product of the separate mind. It is the hypnosis of our social conditioning. The more we question everyday reality as our own construct, the more we actually practice what we're learning here, and more we settle into our being, these windows open. Okay? The brain is an editing device, that's all it is. It edits out infinity so you can experience this. Because your real being is infinite. Creative response, what's my life challenge? To align with the Creator. What's my greatest strength? Infinite imagination. If you're familiar, again, Einstein's quote, imagination is much more important than knowledge. Biggest hurdle is self-absorption. Creative people tend to be a little self-absorbed. Greatest temptation, solipsism, which means that they think, oh, everything depends on me. Which is true at the level of awareness, but not at the level of ego. Life challenge in the higher guidance response is to attain liberation. Liberation means freedom from karma. Greatest strength is holiness. Holiness means all-inclusiveness, wholeness. Biggest hurdle is martyrdom, which means great saints and great visionaries will frequently take on the karma of collective consciousness, whether it's Mahatma Gandhi or Martin Luther King. You can think of a lot of people, starting from Jesus Christ, and then religion will frame that in a certain way. You know, so Catholics and Christians will say Jesus died for our sins. Well, it's another way of saying taking on collective karma. And greatest temptation, promising more than you can deliver. And why is that a temptation? Because, you know, the great seer, the great visionary, the great saint, they have seen what is possible. So they promise that, not knowing that the followers can't do what they do because they're not in that state of consciousness. Sacred response, your challenge is just to be, which is the most simplest thing. Your greatest strength is universality. You don't have a hurdle, and there is no temptation. Okay, so now we go into fulfillment of desire. What do I want? We've been asking these questions in our meditation. We shall continue to ask them because as our consciousness evolves, we'll move into different domains of fulfillment. But fulfillment simply means what fulfills you at the level of desire. So fight or flight response, if the answer to the question is, to the question, what do I want, is I want a good family, I want a good community, sense of belonging, I want material comforts. And of course, once you have them, then you assume that that's okay and you're not still happy, right? You want more. So my teacher Maharishi used to say, never get rid of a desire, because if you try to stop your desire, it will only get stronger and you'll get frustrated. So the only way to fulfill desires to get what you want. And then you keep expanding your desires till you find yourself or you find God. So at this stage, this is what we want. When we fulfill this, then we say we want more. We want reactive, the ego desires, power, success, status, ego satisfactions. As we fulfill and transcend this level, then we want peace, being centered, self-acceptance, silence. As we transcend and fulfill this, we want insight, empathy, tolerance, forgiveness, because we're beginning to understand a little bit more about reality. As we fulfill that, we want inspiration, creativity, we want to be co-creators with what we call God, we want unlimited discovery. As we fulfill that, we want reverence, compassion, devoted service, universal love. And as we fulfill that, we want wholeness and unity with the divine. Finally, we come back to the world of miracles. Remembering what I told you about miracles. Okay? I won't repeat myself. So in the fight-flight response, the miracles involve surviving great danger, impossible rescues, a sense of divine protection. In the reactive response, miracles involve incredible achievements and success, control over body and mind. Why? Because the internal reference point is, how can I show everyone how good I am at this? So this is also a problem with great yogis, okay, who have not yet gone. Not, I shouldn't say a problem, it's a pattern. Nothing is a problem because everything is appropriate for the level that you're at. So, you know, these control over mind, body, it's not that difficult, by the way. If you have some time, I can show you how to lower your blood pressure, heart rate, etc. It's all getting into meditation and introducing an intention, what we're doing with our sutras, but more specifically. Okay, but the internal identity is still ego. As we go into the restful awareness response, then it starts to happen more spontaneously. Synchronicity, meaningful coincidences, being at the right place at the right time, yogic powers without having to focus on them, premonitions, feeling presence. I say here presence of God, but presence of infinite being. Just presence is good enough. As we go beyond that, we begin to have non-local abilities without the need to show off about them. Okay? Like these, the reason I showed you that little clip of these kids is they're not really showing off, right? They're just who they are. And they have a window into particular abilities. I said, 2 weeks from now, I'm going to go see this kid who can look into the past, future with uncanny accuracy. But I'm saying that before I've done the experiment. Yeah, we'll have a video and all of that, and we'll do controls. And that's a window. So telepathy, extrasensory perception, knowledge of the past and future lifetimes, prophecy. In the creative response, divine inspiration, artistic genius, spontaneous fulfillment of desire, wishes start to come true automatically. But artistic genius is a very interesting thing. So as I told you, I was recently at the Vatican, and one of the privileges you get if you're part of a board is go see the vaults and the history and all of that. And so I saw a lot of interesting things over there, including Christopher Columbus's letter to the Pope having found a new continent, Abraham Lincoln's letter to the Pope saying, tell these people that slavery is immoral. Many interesting things. Galileo's letter and Copernicus's letter. But one of the very interesting conversations is between the then Pope and Michelangelo. So the Pope says to Michelangelo, is, what are you going to charge me for painting the Sistine Chapel? And Michelangelo says, you can't afford it. This is the local story that you hear. Okay. So the Pope says, yes, I can. Name your price. He says, you can't afford it. So what are you going to give me? And the Pope says, I'm going to absolve all your sins, past and future. And Michelangelo says, okay, as long as Raphael is not allowed to enter the chapel, he can only paint outside. And they made a deal. History is full of very amazing human frailties. Higher guidance, miracles involve healing, physical transformations, holy apparitions, highest level of supernatural feats. Spontaneous evolution of our consciousness. Now with these kids, they have one window. They don't have all the windows open to the infinite mind. But as we evolve in our consciousness, all the windows start to slowly open. And in the final stage, we realize that everything is a miracle. Okay? Existence is a miracle. And we know that at the level of being. We surrender to infinite being in our own self. Okay, so this was a completion of this morning's talk. I'll do the You Are the Universe tomorrow, but this is getting us in that direction.